This is Ez, and this is the 24 gigabytes of RAM version of the new MacBook Pro M4. It's got a 12-core CPU, a 16-core GPU, and 512 gigabytes of onboard storage in space black. So I'm not usually one for doing this, but I thought it'd be nice to just talk. So this is a sort of raw unboxing, at least for my channel, of the new MacBook Pro M4. I'm gonna go over the setup and some of the things that I change when I get a new device like this. I'm also going to talk about why me, a hardcore Windows slash Android fanboy, has spent yet another £2,000 on a MacBook Pro. So whilst we unbox the new MacBook Pro M4, I just want to talk a little bit about my older laptop, which was the MacBook M2. Now, this was at the time very widely regarded as one of the worst MacBook Pros you could buy for the money. But for me, it was actually perfect. I couldn't find anything comparable in the Windows offerings that could do the 4K video editing I wanted and have the same amount of portability. It's really slim, really light. Yes, it's only got a 13-inch screen, but I did find some ways to get around that. And it's just served me so well. And the only reason that I'm upgrading to the MacBook Pro M4 is, yes, I wouldn't have minded a little bit of extra power, but the main reason being that my fiance wanted a new laptop and somehow I drew the short straw and had to buy a new one and she got my old one. So this one we're unboxing now, in comparison, I can just tell immediately from the box, it's actually a lot heavier for starters, slightly larger with it being 14 inches as opposed to 13. But what I'm really excited to get my hands on is the SD card slot and HDMI port. This is something that I was missing on my M2 and something that actually excites me a lot. Now, not being tuned into the Apple ecosystem quite as well as I am with Androids and Windows, I was a little upset to see the MagSafe charging port. I initially thought this was the only way to charge it, but it turns out you can actually charge it via the USB-C ports as well. I will say on that note though, it feels really good. It's a very nice braided cable and the power brick included is actually a little bit smaller than the last generation I own, which is always a nice thing to have. This time around, I've gone for the space black version. Now, for me, I feel like the space black version's just got that slight elite look, that elevated luxury appeal compared to the last space gray, I think it's called, that I had. The keyboard layout is very familiar, the fingerprint reader being the main difference from my M2 MacBook, and then of course, the lack of that touch display. Speaking of displays though, I accidentally opened the screen and the display turned on, and I instantly noticed that the colors just seemed to be a little bit more punchy, and especially the blacks, they had a lot more depth in comparison to my MacBook Pro M2. And then this year, we've also got a camera notch on the M4 here. Now, this is something that's gonna upset a lot of people, but for me, I see the practical benefits of this. If I compare it to my MacBook M2 Pro, you can see at the top there, this is just taken up by bezel. So for me, I'd much rather this space be used in a practical way. Then there's the overall design of the display this year. The display looks way more premium and futuristic in comparison to my M2 Pro. Now, let's crack on with the setup. I'm gonna go over migrating some of my files from my older MacBook and doing a little bit of personalization, which is my favorite part of getting any new device. So the migration assistant is fairly easy. You just hook up the two laptops with a USB-C cable if you have a more recent MacBook Pro, or you can connect them to the same internet and it'll do it all for you. It's fairly simple and just takes a couple of clicks. Depending on how much data you've got to transfer though, this will be quite a lengthy process. For me, the whole process took around about 2 hours or so. Initially, it was quoting around 9 hours, and that was for approximately 250 gigabytes of data to be transferred from one MacBook Pro to the other. What was really nice with this though is that when it had finished, it hadn't just copied my data over, it put it exactly where it was on my M2 onto my M4. So my desktop was just as messy as how I left it on my M2 Pro, which I'm not quite sure how I feel about that upon reflection. But what I'm trying to say is this should be a really seamless, easy process, especially if you've got a more recent MacBook Pro to move your data from. So once you've got through all these boring bits, it's just a bit of filling in passwords, adding your cards and whatnot. And you also need to do your fingerprint read. It will prompt you to place your finger down in different positions several times. The process should shouldn't take more than a minute or so to get set up. All fairly boring stuff, but we're gonna get to my favorite part now, which is making it mine. And it looks like Ez is also ready for this section as well. And for me, it all starts with a good web browser. I've been using Opera One R2 recently, and I'm loving it for many reasons, so much so that I'm actually gonna show you around a little bit. For starters, just look at this interface. It's sleek, modern, and really complements this laptop in particular. And it has tons of useful features that help me stay productive and have a bit of fun. The music player, for example, on the sidebar offers a choice of 7 different streaming services, for example. And once you start playing some music, you can detach the music player like so and move it anywhere you like. So it's accessible, but not in the way. And then check out some of these themes. They go beyond just the normal dark or light mode. They're dynamic, they're vibrant. My favorite being the midsummer one. This really matches my sort of chill, productive vibe. But Opera One R2 isn't just about looks. For example, it's got this incredible built-in AI called Aria. Check this out, for example. I can ask it to correct the spelling in this sentence, and I can even generate images inside the same chat. In addition to this, if you're a multitasker like me, you're gonna fall in love with the split screen mode. For example, I can research my video on one side and then keep notes on the other. No more switching back and forth between tabs. And speaking of tabs, Opera have completely changed the game here. I'm guilty of having a ridiculous amount of tabs open, but with the tabs islands feature, they're grouped together so I can actually find what I'm looking for. And then tab traces helps me retrace my steps and find the tab I need amongst all the chaos. So these are the reasons why I use Opera One R2 and think you should as well. There is a link down in the description if you want to download it for yourself. Now, next on my list is to find a good wallpaper. Now, I really do think the default Apple wallpapers look brilliant, especially the live wallpapers, but I just like to add a bit more of a personal flair. So there is 3 places that I would go for wallpapers rather than browsing the internet through dodgy sites and trying to work out whether they are actually 4K or not. The first being Pixels and then Unsplash.com. These are free stock photo websites and people post some really high quality stuff and there's no royalties or anything to worry about there. The last place I'd go to is actually the Tech It Easy Discord. There's a wallpapers channel in there. It's pretty much the only active channel, if I'm being honest, but people post really good wallpapers in there all the time, not just for MacBooks, but also for your phone. There will be a link to sign up down below. The ones I'm showing off now, I actually got from Unsplash.com. So if there's any of these that you want, let me know in the comment section of this video and I'll post it in the Discord for you so you can just download it nice and easy. If you were unsure on how to change wallpaper, just simply right click in an empty space on your desktop and then click change wallpaper, and it's pretty self-explanatory from there. Next, we come to a part of the video that I've been both dreading and super excited for, and that is putting on a Dbrand skin. So I will just say, I think the MacBook Pro M4 looks super clean and minimal and sleek as it is, especially in the space black. It definitely doesn't need a skin. I bought this more for protection as opposed to aesthetics, but you let me know in the comment section what you think, skin on or skin off. Now, interestingly, inside this package, they've actually sent 2 separate skins because one of their skins, I believe, is made out of like a sort of metallic foil material, which they say may or may not affect the heat distribution on the MacBook Pro M4. So I'm gonna put the metal one on first, and if there are any issues, I'm gonna switch back to the basic one. You know what, I gotta say, that's gone much better than I thought it would. So there are 2 main reasons why I bought the MacBook Pro M4. The first being the Adobe suite, which is going to be the case for many. And the second is to use with AR glasses. With the screen being a little bit smaller, coming in at just 14 inches, I felt like I needed a little bit of extra something to help me be a bit more productive, especially on the go. And these just make way more sense than an external monitor. They're much easier to carry around. They almost fit in your pocket and you can actually get up to a 250-inch screen or 3 different virtual monitors around you, offering a far better experience than if you were carrying around an external display. They're also very color accurate, which is helpful for video editors like me. And I don't know about you, I like to have my media panel off to the left and various other things going on at the same time. So the more screens, the better. So I've gone ahead and downloaded the Nebula app. This is what allows me to have that huge screen or the 3 extra monitors on my X-Real Air 2 Pro glasses. The really nice thing about these glasses is that you can actually turn the screen brightness right down on your MacBook Pro M4 and work in complete privacy while seeing everything you need to. So it's really great if you want to work on the go. I do have a dedicated video on my channel on the X-Real Air 2 Pro glasses, but if you'd like me to make a video just purely using them with a MacBook Pro M4, do let me know. If there's interest, I'll definitely get around to that. Now for the ultimate test, Premiere and 4K video editing. Now, I know a lot of you are going to be wanting a laptop like this for that exact reason. And let me tell you, I'm actually quite annoyed. Not because this has underperformed in any shape, way, or form. It's because I spent almost £4,000 on my Windows PC, and this seems to be outperforming it. I don't know what it is. Just getting 4K footage into Premiere just seems so much more fluid, smoother, and easier to navigate than when I'm on my desktop PC. I'm yet to really stress test it. I'll do that in my full review. I've just been editing this video as I go along, but I can immediately tell that there's something about it in comparison to my super PC, if you like. And part of me feels like I'm going to end up using this MacBook Pro M4 over my desktop PC more and more from now on. The rest of the Adobe suite also works really smoothly. Adobe Audition worked really well, and then Photoshop has also worked without a hitch. And you know what? I've got more good things to say about the MacBook Pro, and there's one thing that has rather unexpectedly blown me away, and that is the speakers. So they've got a 6-speaker spatial audio setup. For such a small device, they get pretty loud and have a wicked sense of depth and clarity about them with some solid bass. This is just a first impressions video, so I won't go into specs, but let me show you and give you a sense of what they're actually like. Obviously, you're not going to get the same experience as I am through YouTube, but just trust me on this, they are so immersive, which brings me nicely onto media and display. So earlier I mentioned that I was really impressed with the built-in speakers on the MacBook Pro M4, but what about the built-in microphone and camera? So I'm currently recording this segment with both the microphone and camera of the MacBook Pro M4. So image quality, I think, is a little bit ahead of most other laptops that I've seen on the market, and it should definitely eliminate the need to go off and buy an external webcam, for example. There is a little bit of over-sharpening in my opinion, but again, this is to be expected from a built-in webcam. The microphone seems to be relatively clear and punchy. It's picking up a little bit of echo, but again, it is to be expected from a room like this. Back to the image quality, I think it's doing a really good job of balancing all of the colors and the shadows and the highlights. It's quite a difficult room. We've got two fairly large windows on one side and then one balcony window over there, and the sun is currently beaming through. Everything looks really nice and balanced, and to be honest, I think that I look pretty good on this camera at the moment from a purely technical standpoint. I'd say if you are a new content creator, you could probably get away with editing this in a way that it looks a little bit more professional as well. So if you are just starting out on a content creation journey, you might even be able to get away with just this laptop. Let me know in the comments though, I'll be led by you. What do you think of the image quality and the microphone quality of the MacBook Pro M4? Now, I'm doubtful any of you will be buying a MacBook Pro M4 just to watch movies, at least I hope not anyway. But this MacBook has the potential to answer all of your problems for fun and for productivity. So let's do the display first. This option comes with the 14.2-inch liquid retina XDR display. It's got 1600 nits of brightness and I think up to 1000 nits sustained brightness. We'll also get up to a 120Hz refresh rate on this, and considering the resolution, that is really impressive. Now this year, Apple have also offered an extra add-on, if you like, which is the nano texture display. I personally didn't go for this. It's an extra $150. Essentially what it is a matte look display. A lot of other companies are doing this, like Samsung with their phones. I definitely see the appeal, but for me, I didn't want to shell out another £150 on that. It just wasn't worth it for me. Now, whilst we're talking about media, we might as well talk about gaming, sort of. So Apple is not known for gaming, and that's not necessarily because of its capabilities. It's more because game developers just don't make games for the MacBook, simply put. I tried Counter-Strike and Rocket League, which are both meant to be compatible with Mac, but neither of them actually work, so I can't even show them off to you. Interestingly though, there are some larger games now coming to Mac. For example, Baldur's Gate 3 allegedly already works with Mac, and then we have Cyberpunk, which has got an official port coming for Mac coming soon. On top of this, I saw a recent tweet stating that the M4 Max can actually compete with a 4080. This is really exciting and interesting stuff, and could really shake up the laptop world and convert a lot of Windows users over to Apple. But I'm not going to hold my breath breath. Apple don't tend to take too kindly to opening up their ecosystem. Let's see how it goes in a couple of months. If you are planning on doing a little bit of gaming on the MacBook Pro M4 in the future, or just watching movies, you might be interested to know how the battery holds up. So this is very much a first impressions video, so no long-term tests as of yet, but last night I used the laptop on and off throughout the day, starting at 100%, then at about 6 p.m. started using it heavily for video editing, script writing, and I even tried some games up until 11 p.m. You can see from this graph that it took a big hit when I was messing around inside Premiere, but for lighter tasks throughout the day, it barely budged. So at this point, I was left with around 50%. I got about 5 hours exactly of screen on time. So we could estimate based off this usage, we're gonna get around 10 hours of screen on time. That's the average to heavy usage. But bear in mind, I'll definitely need to do some more testing to give a conclusive opinion on the battery life of the MacBook Pro M4. Charging wise, I was also pretty impressed. It popped on just for 5 minutes to see how it'd do and actually went up fairly quickly. Apple state that you can charge it up to 50% in just 30 minutes. This means you're likely gonna be able to make it through a regular day with very minimal interruptions to your work. Just popping it on a couple of times throughout the day whilst you're making a coffee is probably gonna be enough to keep it going. So I'd say the battery and charging, just based off my initial impressions, are good based off what I've seen so far, and that's likely partially down to the macOS Sequoia and the new Apple Intelligence. So Sequoia is still pretty new, but it's actually brought in some really nice features. The best, in my opinion, is the updated Windows tiling feature. This essentially lets you organize your apps in a sort of split screen mode by clicking and dragging to the corners of the screen. There's also minor changes to things like your notes and your calculator app and iPhone mirroring, which brings me nicely onto my main negative point about the MacBook Pro M4 or just Apple in general. I mentioned at the start that I've always been a huge Android / Windows fanboy, but I've had to get over that and start acting more professional so I can give you guys the best reviews possible. And that's opened me up to ecosystems like Apple. And I have been loving using my MacBooks over the past couple of years, but Apple still has a huge problem, and that is this closed off ecosystem. So this new screen mirroring feature only works with iPhone, yet with Android phones, we definitely have the technology to be able to mirror our screens. Why do we need to download third-party apps to make this happen? Windows and Android are not related in any way, yet they've enabled this feature. Why can Apple not do the same? If Apple were to open their doors to other ecosystems and be more accepting of people who maybe have a Windows or an Android device, then I really think the stigma between the whole Apple versus Android thing would die down and people would be more accepting on both sides. Let me know in the comments what you think of this. So I've got a lot more to show off with the Apple Mac Pro M4 in an upcoming full dedicated review, but in the meantime, you might be interested to know a little bit more about those Xreal Air 2 Pro glasses I was using. Click in the top left or right hand corner now to go to that. For now though, I've been Alex, this has been Tech It Easy. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.